and mercy. You've allowed us to travel the busy highways and byways, and you've brought us home safely. Now, Lord, we ask you to stand in this body. Use us to thy glory. Let the words of my mouth,
yes,
the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, and we will proclaim you as the Redeemer. For it's in Jesus' name do we pray and ask it all.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Say amen if you have it.
Amen.
Colossians, the first chapter, verses 9 through 17. It says, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you.
Yes, sir.
And to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding.
Yeah. Yeah.
That ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work.
Yeah.
And increasing in the knowledge of God.
Yes, sir.
Strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us unto the kingdom of his dear Son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins.
Yes, sir.
Who is the image, good God Almighty, of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature? For by him were all things created that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him. Verse 17, praise God. And he is before. Say before.
Before.
All things.
All things.
Say before.
Before.
All things.
All things.
And by him all things consist. You may be seated in the presence of God.
Amen.
This is a powerful scripture reading. I don't know about you. We may not go to Colossians frequently, but this should give somebody an invitation to go more often. Somebody say amen. To hear what God is saying to his people. This is powerful stuff. This is fuel for an empty vessel.
Amen.
I wish the fans could say amen, because we be doing stuff, but you're not getting what you came to church for. This is the fuel to get you to the next place of life.
Yeah.
There is in nature an invisible yet very real definitive line above which you will never see any snakes.
Wow.
Hello, somebody. See, if you were getting ready to go camping, you should have been paying attention to me. I said there is an invisible line, and when you get that high, there are no snakes. Boy, somebody should have jumped on that one right there. I'm trying to tell you that there's a place you can go and there'll be no snakes. Somebody ought to have got excited right there. Somebody know you've been snaked in your life.
You better come on yourself.
That's good.
Oh man, help yourself, preach. I think I will. I have had days in my life that folk I depended on, they snaked me.
Yes, Lord. Yes, yes.
I know you don't want to say amen. They might be next to you. Just wink at me. Amen. So you don't say amen. Just wink at me. But there's a place that you can get high enough that snakes will not exist.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
God help helped me with this one. In my life, I've had some folk that a story that I heard an old preacher tell, I'm reminded of. It's a story about this man who went camping and it was cold. And he was out camping, warming himself at the fire, and he went down by the water. And on the way down, he saw this beautiful red with gold ringlet object laying on the ground. And after close examination, he picked it up, and it was a petrified, frozen snake. And he looked at it, and he was mesmerized. You know snakes will mesmerize. Somebody say amen. He was mesmerized as he looked at it. He began to say, oh, how beautiful this is, and how terrible it is that it's dead, and oh, I wish I, and he put it in his pocket, and he said, when I get back by the fire, I'm going to warm it up. He began to stroke on it. You know, we will play with snakes. Don't look at me funny. Oh, and he began to just rub on it. Somebody said he was rubbing a snake. You better watch out, because you might be rubbing a snake. But he rubbed the snake. He began to just stroke on it. He went by the fire. He said, poor little snake, I wish I could do something for him. And he kept rubbing the snake, and he felt a faint movement. And he says, I believe the snake may not be dead. And he began to stroke it a little more, and he rubbed it. You do know if you play with a snake, it might come alive. And he kept rubbing the snake. And all of a sudden, the snake's little head began to wiggle very slowly and methodically. And he became excited about life coming back into the snake. And he rubbed him. And he rubbed him. And he rubbed him. And the snake's little tail started to move him. And he rubbed him. And he says, if I hold him close, my body heat may bring him back to life. And it started to work. The little snake started doing what snakes do, moving in a snake way. And all of a sudden, the snake bit him. And as he lay there beginning to go into rigor mortis, he said, little snake, when you needed me, I tried to help you. He said, I loved you. He said, before I die, can you tell me why you bit me? He said, you knew I was a snake when you picked me up. Some of us won't realize you've been playing with snakes until you've been bitten. So that's the reason I come to you today, to try and to encourage you how to live above the snake line. Somebody ought to say amen. If you've made it to any age of life and nobody has ever betrayed you, then you need to really give glory to God. But if someone's betrayed you and you're here today, you should glorify God even the more that all of the venom they had, they didn't kill you. But I'm trying to encourage you that we can live above the snake line.
That's good.
For there are going to be snakes at home. Snakes. At the job.
Amen.
Sorry. Snakes. At school. Snakes. At the church.
Snakes.
Snakes. But the good news is that I got a snake charmer. That Jesus is a snake charmer. I'm glad that's what I come to church for, is learn how to deal with snakes. If I wasn't in church, I could tell you there were some days that my behavior imitated a snake. If it had not been for the Lord, who was on my side, I'd still be squirming. I'm not trying to let you believe that I'm above snake behavior. Some of you act like you've never been a snake. The fans don't turn fast enough, as warm as it's in here right now. Some of us know that some folk trusted us And that was their first and last mistake. That we have not always been the best of people. But I'm glad that God has a word to teach us how, now that we're trying to be better people, how to live above the snake line. We have to learn that this word of God is good, just as the Lord has drawn an invisible line in the mountains which snakes cannot pass. There's a spiritual snake line as well. There's a level of living that is higher than the world understands. There's a level that we can achieve that snakes can no longer bother. Somebody ought to say amen. There's a level of life available to God's people that allows us to live lives that are holy and pleasing unto God. We are free from many of the problems that causes the ways of the transgressors. We are able to live a life that is holy and acceptable unto God. Somebody ought to say amen. I realized that most of the time that I had snake bites, I was in a snake pit. You don't want to be honest about our lives. You want to come to church, act like you've never been to nowhere but church. You want to act like you've never sang any song but Amazing Grace. You want to act like when Marvin Gaye used to come on that you didn't know what he was singing about. Act like you've never been to a house with a blue light and they would turn it off at the right time. Act like you've never been to the no-tail motel. Act like you always, always. That's the reason we can't get folk interested in coming to church. There's so many dignified folk, so many holy folk that I don't know where I fit in. Maybe you fit in with all of us, because the Bible says that we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means we have all been a little slippery. That it wasn't just a dance called the snake. It was some folk called snakes. And I'm glad that God has given me some facts that we can consider today. Let's consider these facts, lest I hold you here too long. The first thing in verses 12 through 14, we have been elevated above the snake line. That this message is for God's saved children. These are for the ones who have put their hands in the master's hand. And we have been elevated above the snake line. When we were born into this world, we were born into the lowlands of sin. I don't care how good you are, David, a man born after God's own heart, he said in Psalms 51, in sin yet did my mother conceive me. I want you to know, I don't care how good you look today, how holy you feel, you can speak in tongues known and unknown, you can be slain in the spirit, but when you get up, you must realize that you were born in the lowland of sin. The Bible is clear that we have all been in that sinful place at one time or another. The Bible makes it clear and adds to that fact that every sinner is dead in their sins and trespasses, as we see in Ephesians 2 and 1. And that as well, we walk according to this world, according to the princes of the power of air, and the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience. We were made known that we all have been in the snake pit. We have all been in a place where, if it had not been for the Lord who was on my side, that I would have died in a snake pit. I'm glad today that I have a propensity to stay out the snake pit. It don't mean that I don't go in, but I don't stay in. I might have some weaknesses yet, but I'm not wicked anymore. Somebody ought to say amen. We all have some issues we're still wrestling with. If you're not an X something, you an active something. You look at me funny. If I followed you last night, I would know some of your activities for this morning. It lets us know that we all have had that conversation in times past, lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind. And we are by nature children of wrath, even as others. That Ephesians 2 was letting us know that we have a proclivity and a propensity to sin.
Yes.
So don't sit up here looking like you have never been there. Guess what? The reason I know you sin is because in the middle of sin is I, and I is you. So we have all sinned. We have all come short of the glory of God. We have all been on the wrong side of the law. The Bible said, while you were yet a sinner,
yes, sir.
Christ directed his love towards you.
Yeah.
He commanded love towards you while you were yet a sinner.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Oh, yeah. The image becomes crystal clear that we have all been in the snake pit.
Yeah.
But the good news is that when we were born again, that we were elevated above that type of behavior.
Yes.
It doesn't mean that you forget it.
Amen. That's right.
I didn't forget how to curse. I just choose not to.
Yes,
amen, somebody.
Amen.
I didn't forget how to fight. I just choose not to.
Amen.
I didn't forget where all of the dope dealers lived when I was in Cleveland. I just chose not to go visit them. Somebody ought to say hallelujah. I didn't forget where all of my ex-girlfriends was at. I just remembered I had a wife. Somebody ought to say amen up in here. Don't act like you better than me. Some of y'all need to empty some text messages. If you gonna look at me funny, you need to delete some folk from your Facebook. If you gonna look at me funny. I just want you to know the lowland of sin is a place of spiritual poverty and depravity, weariness, exhaustion, and collapse. It is a place of hopelessness, sorrow, confusion, and pain. It is a place of broken hearts, shattered dreams, ruined relationship, and troubled mind. It is a place where the vicious serpent of sin interject their poisonous venom over and over, bringing pain and destruction into our lives. The lowlands is a place of terrible danger. When I grew up, I used to like to watch Lost in Space with Will Robinson. And the robot would be there, and when they would get into a place, he would say, "Warning, Will Robinson, warning, there's danger." Well, I stand up this morning to tell you, warning time, he'll warning you. It's danger in the lowlands. It's problems in the lowlands. It's poison in the
lowlands.
You don't want to have church this morning. I had church by myself. I'm preaching better than you, amen, right now. Here's how the New Testament describes it. In the flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. In 2 Thessalonians, it let us know that there's a prepared place for unprepared people. I didn't come to play with you today. I came to give you the warning from God that it's time for God's people to live above the snake line. It's time for us to quit playing with snakes, because they will wake up and bite you. It's time that we realize it's no playtime in church anymore. I'm tired of coming to church, playing church, acting like everything's all right. I had to tiptoe around some
snakes.
Y'all can look at me funny, but I can look at your feet and see bite marks on them. Some of y'all know you have been in the snake pit, baby. And I'm trying to tell you that God's children must live above
the snake line.
That's the condition of the lost sinner, is that they don't realize. See, when I was doing what I did, I thought being with the people I was being with was a thing to do. You can put your stuff right in there with mine. But when I learn better, I now
do better.
God is looking for some do better saint. He's looking for some do better folk. Some folk who come to get the word, to swallow it, digest it, so we can
do better.
Oh, you don't even want to say it. I'm looking for some folk who want to
do better.
Do you want to
do better?
I'm going to
do better.
Got to live above the snake line. Got to live above the snake line. Verse 12, we have been made to be partakers with the inheritance of the saints in the light. So if that's true, why are you playing in the dark?
Good question.
Why, if we're saints with an inheritance, and you do know what an inheritance is. An inheritance is something that's given to you that you didn't deserve. It's something somebody else worked for, loved you enough to leave it to you. Don't look at me funny. Y'all have been to some family fights. $2 get left on the table and everybody want their portion out of it. Don't look at me like you don't know about inheritance. If you don't know, don't leave a will and watch how your, well, you won't be here, but your children will fight over $2. They will quit talking to each other for years over $1.50. Baby, I tell you, they want to cut up the slip. They want to take your whole slip and make a half slip out of it, because everybody wants something that they didn't work for. But the inheritance, that's what he's talking about, of the saints in the light. This phrase means believers have been given their portion of eternal glory. Those who are already heavenly bound need to understand that what you have was a paid for, but not your work, but the finished work of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, on a hill called Calvary. I wish I could walk through this. I got more sermon than you got time, but I want you to understand that verse 14 let us know that we have redemption through his blood. The word redemption means that we have been bought back. We were lost and God bought us back. That means you were gone and God saw fit to extend himself to bring you back. Somebody ought to say amen. That means you were on the brink of going to hell. God looked out of glory, saw you and said, I need to do something to get you back. And God made a purpose in his heart that he was going to bring you back. Let me see if I can hodgesize this and get out of here. I remember a little boy, he built a boat and the boat was important to him. And little boy lived on the coastline and he loved the boat and he spent hours carving and shaving on it. He wanted the boat to be seaworthy. And every once in a while he would try the boat, lay the boat in water and the boat wouldn't float. So he kept working on it. He took some pitch and sealed the boat so that the boat would be seaworthy. And when the boat became seaworthy, one day he went out on the shore. He sat it there. A gust of wind came, pushed the boat off into the middle of the water. The little boy was standing on the coast looking at the boat. He said, my little boat that I love so much is drifting away. He couldn't reach to get it. He watched the boat as it drifted off into the horizon. He was hurt that the boat was gone. He walked around head down, hurt, discouraged, dismayed, discombobulated, because his boat was gone. Somebody said the boat was gone. The boat had got away from him. But the little boy, he went around town worrying and crying and worrying about this little boat. And one day he went by a merchant store and he looked in the window and he saw the boat and he said, that's my boat. And he went in the store and the man said, no, sir, I bought this boat from a man. He was a merchant seaman and this is my boat. Now, if you want this boat, you're going to have to pay for the boat. I'm not going to just give you something I paid for. So the little boy said, well, how much is it? He said, I don't have that much money. But the little boy was determined. He wasn't like he went to work for the boat. He kept counting his money, looking at his pipe. He said, I don't have enough yet, but I'm going to get the boat back. Somebody said, get the boat back. The little boy kept working for the boat. He kept working for the boat. And one day he had enough. He went in the store. He laid everything he had on the line. He said, I want the boat back. The man looked at him. He said, you have enough to get the boat. The little boy got the boat. He began to cradle the boat and look at it. He said, I'll never let you go again. You are my boat for life. I'm trying to tell you something as I get ready to get out of here. That's how you were. We had got so far away that we had drifted into the abyss. But one day in glory, I hear Jesus say, I see the little boat again. And that little boat, he said, it was my boat. I made the boat, but I'm going to go and buy the boat back. Well, how you going to buy it back? One Friday on a hill called Calvary. The boat. I was a little boat. You was a little boat. We had drifted away from the Lord. And but one Friday on the Via Dolorosa, he hung up so that we can elevate above a snake line. He can tell snakes beware. I'm a snake killer today. I'm looking for a snake. I'm like Moses. I'll hold up the snake in the wilderness. Why? Because I have been bought again. He didn't just create me, but he bought me back. When I should have been lost in the abyss, one Friday, he ascended up on Golgotha. He stretched himself. himself out wide. They hung him high. He dropped his head in the locks of his shoulder. And the Bible said he died. Somebody say he died. He died so that we could live above snake. He died so you can get along with folks today. He died so you can forgive folks today. He died so we can have real friends and family today. He died so that we can be men and women of purpose today. He died so we can be the people he called us to be. I said he died so that we could let some things die at the church today. There are some fights at the church that need to die. There are some issues at the church that need to die. There are some things I'm going to forget about and let them die. There are some things at home I'm going to let them die. There are some things at my job I'm going to let them die. There are some things in my community I'm going to let them die. There are some things at Zion Hill so we can be family. We got to let them die. But don't worry if you let them die. I stand to tell you that on the third day morning, strike his heel, but he said he'd crush his head. Somebody ought to say, the snake is dead. Say, the snake is dead. Say, long, long live the king. Because early Sunday morning, he got up with all power. I say, he got up with all power. He got up with all power. Somebody ought to say, power. Say, power. Say, I got snake proof at church today. For the afternoon. Whoever shows up, I'm gonna love him. I'm snake proof. Go home and tell your friend, say I'm snake proof, baby. Go home and tell your enemy, say I'm snake proof today. Say by the love of God, by the blood that ran down Calvary, I'm snake proof today. I'm gonna live above the snake line. If you're gonna live above the snake line, you got to have a call from glory. If you want to ascend to above the snake line, you got to have a call from glory. You got to have a call from glory. You got to have a call from glory. You got to know your assignment. I'm a snake killer. Amen, somebody. Somebody need to know that's my job. I come to kill snakes. I don't run from them anymore. By the power of God, by the blood of Jesus, I'm a snake killer. That's the reason we are able to move back into relationships that were broken. Because if the truth be told, we recognize snakes because we used to be snakes. Somebody ought to say amen. Don't get cute on me. Don't get cute on me. Don't get too cute. Don't get too cute, because if you don't know where you came from, you destined to go back there again. If you don't recognize you used to be a snake, you might be a snake right now and not know it. Somebody say amen. You may have some snake behavior right now, but I got the snake tamer, and his name is Jesus. And his spirit is holy. Somebody say amen. If you got issues of life right now, I got the answer for life right now. Somebody ought to say amen. We came in here with some issues. We came in here with some unfinished fights. But I don't have to fight anymore. Because I got a word that says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I don't have to fight no more. Somebody ought to text somebody and say, the fight is over. The fight is finished, baby. Baby, we don't fight no more. I'm getting ready to love the hell out of you. Somebody say amen. That's right, daughter. Send a text. Let them know the fight is over. By the grace of God, the fight is over. And the snake is dead. Amen, somebody. If you don't have a relationship that has made you snake-proof, and you come to church, came in here today feeling snake-bitten, that you feel like I'm losing it. The venom of the snake is overtaking me. And I don't want to die, but I want to have life. And like John 10 and 10 said, that the thief comes, but to what? Steal? kill, and destroy. And wouldn't it be terrible if he'd have parked that scripture there? But he interrupted, he said, but I came that you might have life.
Yes.
And have life more abundantly.
Yes.
If you've come for the abundance of life,
yes,
I can get you to a place where you're above snakes right now. Not